Welcome to the pre-show. As you can see, I'm dangling my legs. It's a nice cool morning. We are looking for the Inkahuma Pride, and I have to really focus on tracks this morning because if we're trying to track them under the rain, I don't think there was that much rain last night. I'd say probably between 5 and 10 mils. A nice little sprinkle, get those wild flowers out and hopefully some butterflies. Now, I've remembered today to bring a pen for the butterfly checklist. Last wet season, we got about 25 species. Hopefully we can add a few more to that. So those of you who keep your butterfly lists, get ready. And I think it might be a nice morning for the birdies as well. I don't think the cloud is going to stay too long. The sun is probably going to burn it off and clear, and hopefully we're going to have a wonderful morning. Of course, my name is Brent. We have Jean-André and his unwashed hair on camera today. And we also have an interviewee trying out for the camera department. His name is Desmond. So if you see a third shadow, don't worry. We are not being attacked by a ghastly ghoul on the back. But also, remember, Christmas is coming, and jump onto our website or on our Facebook page, have a look. We have a Christmas shop with lots of goodies, and the sale or the proceeds of the sale of all those goodies is going to take us, hopefully, back to Rwanda, to Zambia, to Liwa Plains, to the Chobe waterfront, to the Mara. So it's to help us get enough budget so we can move our sticky little fingers up Africa. Now, of course, I've spoken about lots of those places on drive, and wouldn't it be exciting to actually go see it live with us? Now, no sign of the Inkahumas just yet. We've got to hope they haven't gone back visiting in the west. And say, if they moved during the rain, it's going to be quite difficult to find tracks. But you never know. My eyes are on the job. Now, as the rain increases, the more the herbivores spread, and the further the lions have to walk, and the harder they have to work for their meals. Of course, they could just hang around and eat baby impalas, but you're definitely going to have quite a few hungry individuals if they do that. I would say a baby impala to an adult lion is the equivalent of a peanut to a human being. Or maybe 3 peanuts. Now, it's going to be interesting as we move around Juma today, because certain areas might have got more rain than others. So there could have been areas that got 15 mils, there could have been areas that got 2 mils. Judging from where we are at the moment, I would say probably still about the same 5 to 10 mils, about the same we got around camp. But the lightning show was exquisite last night. And well done. I've seen lots of those incredible screenshots you guys posted of the Inkahumas with the lightning bolts behind them. So very well done. I haven't had a chance to edit mine yet, but I shall one of these days. Now, out and about with me this morning is my good friend and good singer, Commander Bond. So in a little while we're going to be jumping across to him so he can also bid you morning and start the show. Desmond, you are getting lots of welcomes. Jean-André, embarrass him. There we go. We are evil here. Okay, so not looking too good for the Inkahuma staying in Juma. I haven't seen not even the hint of a track just yet, but we are going to keep checking. I'm going to head now towards Triple M and check our western boundary.
This program features live coverage of an African safari. and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
I'll go to them later. Good morning everybody. It's a cold and blustery morning here in the Western Kruger. You are watching Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
You see us, everyone. Hello.
My name is James Henry.
David is on camera, and as you can see from this quite magnificent shot created by Wing Commander Connor Teagues, we are standing here, or sitting rather, on quarantine clearings. And you can see that summer has not quite taken a full hold here. I was astounded yesterday by the picture we had of this area yesterday from the drone. It does look so much drier than it feels. We had some good rain last night, so I'm sure that you can see the soil is a slightly darker hue of brown than it was yesterday. And hopefully it will turn slightly more green during the course of the day. Isn't this an awesome picture? So that's the mast there. You can see that's where the signal is reaching you from. And you can see this cold and blustery day. Well, it's not cold, but it is kind of blustery, and perhaps a little bit more rain in the offing a bit later on. And that will be quite exciting, I must say. What you can't see from there, of course, is a couple of guinea fowl knocking about here on quarantine, but otherwise there's not much else going on here, other than the general magnificence of the drone, at least not the drone, the general magnificence of the African morning. So there we have some guinea fowl, a little flock that has spent the night. Look at them chasing each other around. They really are quite ridiculous birds. They would have spent the night in one of the tall trees here, hoping to avoid something like a genet climbing up and grabbing one of them, or an African wildcat, or even a leopard. And it's leopards that we are going to go and try and find today. We're going to head down towards the south of the reserve. Now, please do talk to us over the course of the next 3 hours. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Those are the two methods of communicating with us. No other method will work, I'm afraid, at this stage of the game. One day we will teach the directors how to use Morse code, but until then, I'm afraid it is just Twitter and email. That is how you must ask us your questions or give us your comments. Let's talk about Africa. Let's talk about South Africa. Let's talk about the wild, conservation, wilderness, anything to do with those sorts of things. Be lovely to hear from you over the course of the next 3 hours. Out on the other vehicle, Brent Leo Smith is being filmed by Jean Drey. You would have seen them doing the pre-show to the show. And then out on foot a little bit later, Taylor McCurry will be walking about with Herbert. And I'm not sure who's filming them. I think Brian Joubert, the giraffe-like figure of Brian Joubert, will be filming them later on. Okay, let's make a little bit of a move down towards the south of the reserve. Marvelous. Now, everybody, you're going to come with us on a little drive. But you're going to pretend that you're a Bataleer eagle and that you've spotted something nice on the back of this car, perhaps the snack that David has brought for himself. And there you can see us. Luckily, I washed my hair this morning, David. Otherwise, you'd be able to see my dandruff from this angle. We do seem to be heading into a sort of thick Scotch mist down towards the southeast. You might be able to see that from where you're looking. So that'll be quite interesting. I wonder how the drone copes flying through cloud. Connor seems to have lost us now. I mean, he's an inexperienced wing commander at this stage, so it will take him a little while to figure exactly out how to follow us. I can see him. Connor, you're off to the right-hand side. There, I can see you now. You're heading towards... I tell you, watching this drone coming, there are these bright sort of red lights coming. It feels a little bit like... imagine it feels a little bit like it did when you were wandering along and some aeroplane of ill content came over you during a conflict of some sort. But we know that Wing Commander Connor is very friendly and that the drone is not going to mean us any harm. Hello? I don't suppose you can see me waving at that angle. But we'll just slow down a little bit so that Connor can get a bit closer to us. Now this all, everybody, is in preparation, of course, for our television shows. And we're doing a series of 8 weeks from the 1st of January, 10 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, on that Geo Wild. I think, if I'm not mistaken, we're also doing a show on the 15th or so of this month. 15th of this month, that's me waving like a complete imbecile. Here we go, let's get onto the back onto the car before we do some harm. Right, well, that was an excellent start with the drone, I would think, don't you think? Such a lovely way to view the wilderness. Now, of course, for those of you who are perhaps a little inexperienced about all of this, the drone has been used extensively in the past, and we've had to do various things in order to get it up and running again, not least of which is license it, because there have been so many hundreds of different drones, but wait until we follow wild dogs on the hunt or find some elephants or something like that. It's the most amazing way to watch the wild. Let's head across to Brent Leo Smith, who of course has a different perspective on the world than I do, being a head taller.
Yes, fortunately it means I can see all the stumps in front of me. Good morning, my name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Jean Ray on camera with me today. We also have an interviewee on the back by the name of Desmond. There's Desmond. So we are looking for the Inkahuma Pride. That we left them lying up with that magnificent sky behind them last night, lightning striking. We did have a little bit of rain last night, not much, I'd say between 5 and 10 mils. Remember, this is a live safari, so I could go around the corner and there's not a lion today, but there could be, that's the point. And remember, if you want to ask us any questions, use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter or the email address questions@wildearth.tv. So now I've checked around Sydney's waterhole. I've checked the main access road up towards the gate. No sign of the lions. We're going to head towards a last position, but it could be quite difficult with the amount of rain. It's just enough to obscure those tracks if they were moving during the rain that my eyes are going to have to be on fine fettle today to spot them. Hopefully they misstepped in a piece of mud so I can see a nice distinct track to start, so I don't have to start looking for obscure scrapes in the sand. But hopefully they haven't gone back to the west. Hopefully they are still residing on Juma today. But of course, the wonderful thing after the rain, the bush has got this wonderful, clean, fresh smell, and we could get some nice butterflies. Fortunately today I remembered a pen, so we can work through our butterfly checklist. Okay, no obvious lion tracks in that little patch of mud. So off we continue. Quite muggy this morning. You can see there's quite a lot of moisture sitting in the air around the horizon. So there we go, you can just see looking a little bit damp. I don't think it's gonna rain. I just think it's some mist left over. And I'm in two minds. I thought earlier that the clouds might dissipate with the burning African sun. I mean, it was a scorcher yesterday. It went over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. But I'm not sure. Are we going to have a cloudy day? I think we're going to have mist in the morning, and I think it's going to clear by the end of safari. Hopefully it clears to bright sunshine, and every butterfly that's been waiting will pop out and flutter by. We've got to check very carefully. A very good morning to Lisa in New Orleans. Lisa says, we get spectacular storms in New Orleans, but we also get hurricanes and tornadoes. Do we get any of those here? Fortunately, we just get really big storms, Lisa. I think occasionally, very occasionally, sort of once every 50 years, there's a hurricane in the Karoo, not this part of South Africa, but the other. But other than that, we're actually quite stable when it comes to weather and things like that. We don't have hurricanes, we don't have tornadoes, and we don't have earthquakes too often. No, sorry, I just heard a Franklin alarm call. What's that in the gap of that quarry? Is that a damp termite mound?
Which quarry?
That one. It's there. It is a damp termite mound. I thought it could be a slightly damp lion, but it is not. Okay, we saw some tracks here, but I'm pretty sure it was Howard the hyena. Indeed, it is hyena tracks. Now, of course, the Howard is not the hyena's name. It is just my generic nickname for all hyenas. So we left the Inkahumas lying up in the open here on the right last night. That's where they were schnoozing. They are not schnoozing there anymore. Now, while we search for the largest cat on the African continent, James has got some birdies to show you.
Oh, it's a little family, everybody. You can just see the little ones there. I think you can just maybe see the little ones there. Oh, there we go. So four crested Franklins, Mum, Dad, Johnny and Jenny. They're off on their Saturday morning Christmas shopping, I think. I hope they have a good time. Isn't that sweet? A little family out for a stroll on Saturday morning. I think that's wonderful. There are quite a lot of birds around here. A red-back shrike. We saw a brown-hooded kingfisher. We saw a great go-away bird going and having a drink. So we're going to drive very slowly. There's a woodpecker up there, David. Do you see it? Are you able to film it at this angle? There we go. Little cardinal woodpecker. Looks a bit, dishevelled as a result probably of an evening trying to escape the rain. I wouldn't say this is the cardinal woodpecker's best angle. That's probably why it's flown off. Anyway, that was a cardinal woodpecker, so named for the cardinal's cap that it has on the back of its head. Now, a very nice question from you, Matthew, in Michigan, and I don't know the answer exactly. You say we've been talking about migratory birds and birds that come and go. You want to know if any from North America come here. As far as I know, birds that end up sort of on the eastern edge of the Atlantic, in other words, ones that have come across that way, have got lost. They don't do it by default, I think. And one of the obvious ones would be the American golden plover. There's a lovely view of a yellow-billed hornbill. And I will find you a picture of the American golden plover. And I think that it was found here once or twice, and we're pretty sure that it was kind of blown off course on whatever migration. It's eating, oh, that's amazing. It's eating the Bushman's grape or the Mbezana tree, the one that tastes like your roast chicken lunch mixed in with the custard and apple crumble pudding. Let me just try and find you this bird. Mm-hmm. Right, so there are a few birds that have ended up here. These are the vagrants that we get here. The greater yellow-legs has come from the Americas, but there are probably just one or two records. Let me just check. Yeah, a wanderer, it says, from the Americas. So every so often we'll see the greater yellow-legs, but always, if we go to the map here, Dave, on the sort of western coast of South Africa, and that one was seen around Cape Town. I'm sure it hasn't been back since. Definitely, you know, the Capetonians don't like people that are strange to them, so it probably didn't come back. This one breeds in Canada, for example, the Hudsonian Godwit. I don't know why Hudsonian Godwit is such an amusing bird. But that's it there. But it says here, a few South African records, but quite possibly the same individual that's come back to these shores a few times. The Kentish plover, I'm not sure where that comes from there. Doesn't say. And then I just wanted to find. Well, from tormented zombie owl, we've gone to something slightly more terrifying. The zombie cow. At the zombie cow, good morning to you. One cannot but think of Gary Larson and the Far Side comics when one thinks of the zombie cow. I'm sure that's probably where you got it from. Zombie cow, in fact, your name has been so astounding to me that I've forgotten what question you have. I think your question was, are both male and female birds normally the same colour? It's probably about 50-50. You'll find that about 50% of birds are not sexually dimorphic and 50% of the birds are. So 50% will look the same and 50 will not. Right, I think that's kind of it. These are all the birds that we kind of get here as what they call rare vagrants. And those would be the ones that come across from the United States, normally by mistake. I just wanted to check once more for that plover. And so what I'm saying to you is that no bird will by default make the crossing over the Atlantic. I think largely the biggest sea that they cross is the Mediterranean. Yes, absolutely, birds will travel from, of course, the northern Atlantic all the way to the southern Atlantic, at least from the North Pole to the South Pole, almost. But they do that via land, or they have to be birds that that can stay in the air for a hugely long time, like an albatross or something like that. But by default, no. Here they are. I mean, a lot of these things, these funny little sandpipers, will come from the United States, but they are very rare vagrant shorebirds, they're described as. Right, I think that's quite an extensive discussion on that subject, and perhaps we shall move on from it. Now African grey parrots, Diane, you say, do we ever see them? I have seen a number of them, Diane. Unfortunately, they've all been in captivity. An African grey parrot is found in the Congo Basin, so they're a forest species that you'll find up in the forests of the Congo Basin of Central Africa. You wouldn't find them here. There are a number of South African parrot species. We get the Cape parrot, the grey-headed parrot, the Mayer's parrot, and of course over here, the brown-headed parrot. But the African grey, which is about that big, occurs in enormous flocks in the Congo Basin, and unfortunately the only thing that threatens it is our idiocy as a human species. We capture them and then sort of sell them off as pets. Many of them have, of course, been raised in captivity, but they only occur where it's much wetter. There were some incredible pictures. If you Google pictures of African grey parrots in the wild, massive flocks of them, sort of 50 or 60 birds, coming down to the waterholes, or the byes as they call them, which are the clearings in the Central African rainforest. It's really quite astounding to have such a number of those birds. But no African grey parrots here. Well, we're going to attempt to find a leopard this morning, as I said, but I do think that It's probably unlikely because they seem to head south with a purpose yesterday, indicating that they may well have a kill. Let us go and find out how Brent Leo Smith's search for the pug marks of the Inkahumas are. And I just wanted to say to you that all six cubs obviously were found yesterday. I hadn't seen them since the two went missing at Biffleshook Dam, so all is okay there. Let's go and find out if Brent's found them yet.
We've stopped looking for lions. We're over lions. Wild dog tracks. So I'm going to get a hold of James. I think he's near Biffleshook. He needs to head up towards the Sydney's Dam area. These tracks look like they're going... Oh, dear. Sorry about that. That's bushwalk alarm. Okay, so... Tracks are going into Juma. I just want to make sure. They could have just stopped here for a scent mark and then... There we go, perfect scent mark. Come on, go this way. Go this way. We're also listening in case the dogs get separated for that wonderful woo call. Woo, 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 woo. Not seeing any tracks here, so we just go back. I'm not smelling them, so they haven't passed here within the last 10 minutes or so, maybe a little bit earlier. So there's tracks of at least two dogs. They met over here. And they're both coming here. Now it's the one problem. Oh, there's more tracks behind the vehicle. Sorry, I'll be back in a second, Jandre. They're going into Juma. Okay. Time. As you know, time is of the essence with the African wild dog. Oh dear. Clippity clip clip clip. No, let's take it this way. So they're all around here. Dogs can move up and down. I'm just gonna double check they haven't been sort of moving quite to this road. I mean just keep up with the dog tracks. Let's go see what James is up.
We're coming down towards the southern end of the reserve into this kind of thick weather above our heads. We don't know, of course, whether it's going to rain again. I would be very excited if it did, I must say. David, there's a bird up there. He doesn't look so happy to be out in the morning, hoping for some sun to dry its feathers. It is, of course, everybody, a starling. And it is either a greater blue-eared glossy starling or a Cape starling. Cape glossy starling. Go ahead, Brent. Brent is hailing me on the radio. And we know that from its yellow eye and its size. The only other thing it could possibly be would be a Birchall starling, but it is most certainly not a Birchall starling given its yellow eye. Brent, go ahead. Brent Leo Smith, quite interestingly, he's in a slightly difficult signal area, but he's got tracks of wild dogs. Copy that, thanks. Keep me posted. Which is very nice, coming towards this sort of area, so we'll keep our eyes open. We know, of course, that Brent Leo Smith and I both like wild dogs quite a lot. And Vulpine Wolf Girl, with certainly an astounding Twitter handle, you make a very good point, and you're absolutely right, and we've done it before. You say wild dogs and a drone would be fantastic. It is incredible. We had a lovely sighting one morning where I was following them through the bush, and it became impossible to see them from our angle. We sent the drone up, and you could see the dogs moving through the what looks like a very thick area from up here, at least from where we're sitting at this angle, but from on top looked much clearer. And as the dogs moved, you could see the vehicle trying to find them, and it was the most wonderful way to watch them on the hunt. Also, because we weren't that close in the vehicle, they could use their ears to hunt. And I think they use their ears a huge amount to hunt, so the drone is actually a very good way of watching them without disturbing the way they're moving and their ability to communicate. Going to drive a little bit faster. We've come to the southern boundary. Now, of course, after this rain, very difficult to see what happened went up in the evening. But if we've got wild dog tracks, the chances are they've been moving after the rain. So during the course of, as it got light, they would have started to move. So with any luck, we'll have some of them sometime soon. But seeing whether those leopards have come across or not is going to prove slightly difficult unless they moved fairly recently. All right, this is the southern boundary of our traversing area. In case you're a new viewer and you're wondering what on earth I'm talking about, what I mean is that due to human property laws, we cannot go to the right, but we can go to the left. The animals, of course, are free to come and go as they please. And that's throughout the 3.5 million hectare, 8.5 million acre Greater Kruger National Park and into the Limpopo National Park of Mozambique and the Gonarezou National Park of Zimbabwe. Yes, Michael. Very good question, but I think it extends into all the other animals as well. You say, where have all the buffalo gone? The buffalo, Michael, have gone the way of the elephants. They have gone the way of, I think, many of the water buck. They've gone the way of various other species. And what that means is they've moved off to where it has started raining. We had a tremendous concentration of animals on this tiny patch of land. I mean, tiny is relative, of course. The expanse of the Greater Kruger. Because we had... I'm just going to stop here. We had isolated early rain, which meant there was a flush of green on Juma that there wasn't anywhere else in the Sabi sand. And that meant that everything came up here. And for about a month, we had such a wonderful time with the animals that we had here. Now what's happened, of course, is that most of the beaten off juice has flushed there, and that's off to the standing water and the green flush at other areas.
We do apologise. We have had a bit of rain, lightning and thunder. So we are, Alex and the tech crew are busy trying to sort out the problem. Hopefully you're with us now. So we're still in search of those wild dogs. The tracks don't seem to come out on Impala Road, and they might head back towards the west. I'm just trying to get hold of the guys in the western sectors and see if they've got any update. But it definitely looks like they haven't come deeper into Juma, which is very sad, for me at least. But you never know. That's the joy of wild dogs. They might pop up anywhere. Incredible creatures, incredibly fast creatures, capable of maintaining 65 kilometers an hour for up to 8-9 kilometers. So they can be through a Juma in a matter of minutes. Now, we just immediately went to check the big herd of Impala that was at Sandy Patch. They look all very relaxed, so the dogs definitely didn't go that way. So far, just hyena tracks in this area. Good morrow, Fuzzman Sparkles. Oh, buffalo! Fuzzman Sparkles is wondering whether the wild dog pups would have left the den by now. I was just saying I hadn't seen buffalo in so long yesterday. Now we've just found a little breeding herd. And it's in the area where the Nkomas are. I wonder if they've caught another buffalo. But yes, the wild dog pups would have left the den by now. They leave quite young. At about 4 months, they're already mobile with the pack. Now, there we go. Very small herd of buffalo. Now, even though we've got grass and whatnot. Now, Michael was asking James where all the buffalo were. There's zebra running in behind them, and none of them are looking relaxed. I wonder if the lions aren't. Somewhere behind is a herd of zebra stampeding in from the rear. And that is a very determined walk. I'm trying to listen if we can hear anything. Now, as we know, the Nkomas have been focusing on buffalo. Or maybe the zebra's got a fright from something else. Just going to keep up with these buffalo for a little bit. The sound of a buffalo herd is like the sound, or to a lion, like the sound of the ice cream truck is to a small child. Seem to have slowed down a bit. Now, Michael, there we go. They're the buffalo, not many. Now, of course, at this time of the year, they do spread out a lot. But when you see a small group like this and as panicky as they're looking, they could be part of a larger herd that has been separated by the kitty cats. Or they could be moving into a lion ambush. So we're not sure which direction the Nkomas have gone because of the rain. So these buffalo could quite easily be walking into their demise. You can see they still haven't picked up all the condition since from the drought. There's still some very skinny, very lame looking buffalo. Some, you can see some of their legs not looking well. I'm trying to see if I can see any fresh scour marks from big cats on them, and not yet, but I think I might go check where they came from if we get no luck while following them. Now, see, they've slowed down. Some impala up ahead as well. Now, buffalo and the hippo have probably been the two species hardest hit by the drought. Do we see any lions jogging in behind us? No, not yet. This is where we found the lions on foot yesterday, was right here. I'm just scanning on the edge there, almost hoping to see the flattened ears of Amber Eyes as she approaches to leap upon the back of a buffalo. You can see the mist and moisture in the air. So it looks like they're going to cut through the block towards Impala Plains. And we're going to do the same, except we're going to go around on the road.
All right, we've just come to Twin Dams, everybody, and what we're doing is waiting for the drone to get itself into the air. It's just arrived here. We'll show you Connor there. We're also hoping, of course, to find some tracks of Kurula, the queen, but she hasn't been seen around here, and so I think she's probably still down in the south. There is Connor. Let's see how quick he is to get his... to get his little toy into the air. Come on, Connor, hurry up. Gee, look at the muscles in the man's shoulders. That's very impressive, eh? It really is quite something. You know, it's what it is to be young, David. To be young and vigorous. Unless you say maybe we can use the drone to spot elephants and giraffe. Well, that is certainly the idea, Liz. Yesterday, I don't know if you were watching, everyone, but I said I thought we were not using the old drone. We were using the new, much more sophisticated one. That is not the case. The camera's giving us some difficulty on that one. So we are using the one that we used to use, that the drone commander, Andrew Francis, first gave us visual of. But it does very effective, and the sort of tying that in with Lissa's comment. Sorry, I'm going to get back to you now. That is the scimitar bull. Did you see it fly across there, Dave?
That's the
yard landed there, and that's the one that we saw in the nest yesterday, I think, on a tree not far from here on our bushwalk. Liz, what we're hoping with the more sophisticated drone, of course, has got a much sort of wider zoom on its camera, and that means that it will be much more successful at finding animals than this one currently is, although the pictures, I think, from this drone are utterly spectacular. So that was a scimitar bull, and it's got a nest not too far from the Hardy-Dar's nest, which we'll go and have a look at right now. I'm just going to turn the car around. We're going to go to the front of the dam wall here and turn around. The drone commander seems to be climbing back into his vehicle, indicating that he's almost ready for takeoff. I have to just turn around, I'm afraid. We'll be doing a 78 point turn here, everyone. We couldn't go any further forward. Ending television, isn't it, David? Right, there we go. Occur. It hasn't occurred just yet. We had a small deluge last night of about 10 millimeters of rain, which is about just slightly less than half an inch. It doesn't seem to have created a huge amount of flooding, which is well, a good thing in some ways, not such a good thing in terms of the dams, but you can see the dam. Then over in front of us, as Connor flies down towards the east, the direction that you are with him now, He's looking north, and then you're going down over what was the actual twin dams. When Mluati was the Mluati drainage that you can see just below. That's the old dry riverbed. And I reckon that this must be one of the most picturesque parts of this reserve, and so a really good spot to be flying around on top of us. You can see the green ribbon, I'm sure from where you are, that the Mramati drainage, the much taller trees. And what we're going to do is tree and see if we, oh, there we are. Davey's just going to create a picture of the Hardy-Dar's nest. And there you can see us waiting patiently for the queen to emerge, or perhaps the hornbills to come and feed their babies in their nest not too far from here. There are some Egyptian geese not too far away as well. They had 7 youngsters. I'm looking at them now, they don't seem to have any right now. They're off to the what would be my left-hand side. So from the direction you're looking, yes, definitely your left-hand side as well from your picture. You won't be able to see them from all the way up there. Isn't that a wonderful extent of things that you can see there? That's so cool. There. Now, from the sort of what would we say, almost in orbit height, we've come straight back down to Earth, and there, the Hardy-Dar mum sitting on her little babies. And I think she's sitting on them on account of the fact that it's not that warm for little baby birds at the moment. They've just got their little downy feathers. That's all they have at the moment. And so she's sitting looking quite surprised by life, isn't she, David? She looks very much like she's shocked. Something's said something deeply offensive to her, and she's looking at us going, "You can't be serious." But we are serious. Yes, very. So that's the Hardy-Dar nest. Now, I saw Mr. Hornbill land not too far from here. I'm just going to go a little bit further forward and show you his nest, because eventually these little things are going to come out. Now, it's, you know where it is, Dave. The second fork from the left, there's a slit. They're right in the middle of your picture there, yeah. Up a bit? Yeah. That one there, yeah. Down a bit. That funny slit there, believe it or not, is where the hornbill's nest is. There's a beak. You can just see the little, is that a beak or was it a knot of wood? No, it's a knot of wood. But that is where the hornbill has been feeding its youngsters, and we haven't quite managed to catch it doing it yet. It flies in here with a caterpillar in its beak. The beak emerges from that little gap, grabs the caterpillar, and then disappears back inside. So I'm just going to wait here for 1 minute and see if Mr. Hornbill doesn't come back, because it really is quite fascinating how a bird the size of a hornbill got into a slit of the tree that size is almost completely beyond me. I do find it very amazing indeed. And then while we wait, what we will do from here, everybody, is probably continue sort of off towards the east and see what else we can find. I don't think Karula's come back north. We might also, I suppose, head across to Aratuza and see if we can't pick up on Shadow, who was seen yesterday. I'm glad she was seen. I got into big trouble the other day for calling her a tragic figure. But she is a rather tragic figure, and it's lovely to spend time with her and hope that before not too long she will have another baby, maybe. And maybe this one she'll be more successful with. Hornbill is not coming back. He's not playing ball. Michael, Good one from you. Another good one from you today. You want to know about parenting amongst the hardy dars? Does one feed the chicks more than the other? Michael, I think yes, but I think because one of them sits at the nest most of the time. But they definitely both play a role and they form a monogamous pair bond. Now, in this tree here, just you see the bottommost trunk is the hoopoe's nest.
Is the hoopoe's nest.
That's it, that's the hole. And the African hoopoe has a nest in there. And they seem to be less frequent visitors than the hornbills. So I've only seen them go in there once. I've never seen them come in again. Lots of lovely bird song. And then also, of course, Darvey, I don't know if you can see, but the sun has just peeped out through the clouds over the top of the tree there. Hint, hint, that would be a nice shot. Oh, look at that. Beautiful. King is right, well, there we are. not really sure where to drive at this stage. I think we'll avoid the riverbed. I think that might not be a great signal. And we'll head up towards Mumba Road and go across there. Now, everybody, you can wave at Connor Teagues. Good morning, Connor.
Morning, Connor.
Sorry, good morning, drone commander.